Right, so first epistle of Peter, verse 8, talking about our faith in Jesus Christ. Whom having not seen, ye love, in whom though now you see him not, yet believing, you rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory. We don't see him, but we love him. We don't see him yet, yet we believe in him. In other words, maybe there's a point in which he will be made known and be seen, you know. Verse 9, receiving the end of your faith, even the salvation of your souls. You can refer there to Ephesians 1:13 and Romans chapter 8, verse 23, where it talks about, you know, where we will receive that salvation of our bodies and salvation of our souls. We will not be bound anymore with the limitations of our bodies. Amen. Verse 10, of which salvation the prophets have inquired. Now from here on, we got to listen and we got to hear what the Spirit has to say. Of this salvation the prophets have inquired and searched diligently, and who prophesied of the grace that should come unto you. So there's a grace that should come after the grace of salvation. Okay, apart from the fact that we are saved by grace through faith, not of ourselves, it's a gift of God, there's another grace that the prophets inquired about, searched about, knowing that there's going to be another grace that's going to come to us, and we got to find out what this grace is, especially at this time of history where so many preachers talk about grace. It's like everybody now want to preach grace. I don't know what else you can preach. I mean, there is no other gospel but the gospel of grace. I've been preaching it 33 years, and now all of a sudden, oh, grace, grace. You know, there is no other gospel but grace. But now people are catching on to that. You don't have to judge. You don't have to condemn. You know, and now all of a sudden, everybody wants to preach grace. So maybe God is saying something. Why is everybody preaching grace to people that have already received grace? Well, I'm just asking a question. So maybe the prophets inquired and searched about a grace that must be revealed to people, because this letter is written to people that's already saved. Listen to verse 11. Searching what or what manner of time the Spirit of Christ which was in them did signify when he testified beforehand the sufferings of Christ and the glory that should follow. Okay, so in other words, the grace that we're going to talk about in the few minutes tonight is not the grace of salvation. Not the grace that we are saved from sin and unrighteousness, but a grace that the prophets inquired about, and now he starts explaining this grace. He says, this grace refers to the sufferings that should come upon the Christ and the glory that's supposed to follow that sufferings. In other words, this grace is supposed to reveal to us the glory that must come to the church. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 7 and 8 says, if the rulers knew who the Lord of glory was, they would never have crucified him. As it is written, verse 9, the eye hath not seen and the ear hath not heard, neither has it come up in the heart of man, the things that God has prepared for those that love him. In other words, if they knew that the sufferings of Christ would bring forth glory that will be so great that no eye has ever seen it, no ear has ever heard it, no heart has ever perceived it, they would never have crucified him, knowing that that sufferings of the cross would only produce in something so much greater that will be called glory. What type of glory is this? John chapter 1 verse 14, we're going to do it later again. The Word was made flesh and dwelt amongst us, and we beheld His glory. The glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. So Jesus was full of glory. John chapter 2, when Jesus turned the water into wine, the Bible says, and He showed forth His glory. Lazarus's tomb, Mary and Martha says, Lord, if You were here, our brother would not have died. Jesus said, have I not told you, if you would believe, you would see the glory of God. So Jesus was manifesting forth the glory of God, but He was the only one that could manifest the glory. So if they knew who the Lord of glory was, they would never have crucified Him. For Jesus says, if a corn of wheat does not fall in the ground and die, it abideth alone. But when it dies, it bringeth forth a rich harvest, just like Himself. So they didn't reckon with the fact that when Jesus would die, Hebrews chapter 2 verse 6 through 14, he would bring many sons into glory. So many sons would come forth in the very same glory as the Son of God, and they would then also be called sons of God. If the devil knew it. In other words, he haven't got foreknowledge. If he would knew that Jesus Christ was the King of glory, the one that would bring glory, he would not crucify Him, knowing that His crucifixion would bring forth sons that will be full of glory. Now he's going to sit with the Lord of Christ. So we got to realize, you know, what this prophet searched for, what they diligently studied for, to find out what is this glory, this second grace that would come to the church of Jesus Christ. Verse 12, unto whom it was revealed that not unto themselves, but unto us, they did minister the things which are now reported unto you by them that have preached the gospel unto you with the Holy Ghost sent down from heaven, which things the angels desire to look into. This glory that all the prophets studied, searched about, tried to find out, that if the rulers of this world knew, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory, knowing that after the sufferings, this glory would follow. In other words, now there's people preaching unto you that this glory must come. And when this glory comes, this is the thing that the angels long to look into. Now imagine the angels has been there before people were there. Before men were created, angels were already created. Now imagine those angels after thousands of years still longing to look into something that up to now they have not yet seen, because it's still futuristic there in Peter. Verse 13, wherefore, gird up the loins of your mind, be sober, hope to the end for the grace that is to be brought unto you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. And I think so many people struggle to get it because they put the revelation of Jesus Christ still is as a futuristic book. But when Jesus appeared unto John on the Isle of Patmos, he said, write down the revelation of Jesus Christ, which he gave unto his servant John to reveal unto his servants the things that are soon come to pass. So in other words, Jesus already revealed him unto the apostle John. So maybe some of us will wake up tonight and get a revelation of Jesus Christ. He says, as soon as we get this revelation of Jesus Christ, this grace will come to us. The prophets prophesied, searched, to try and find out about a grace that must come. Then they realized it was not for them. Then they said it will be for a people to whom the gospel will be preached, that will understand the sufferings of Christ and the glory that should follow. it was revealed unto them that this grace will come when people will get the revelation of Jesus Christ. Things that angels long to see. So gird up your mind. The Amplified Bible says, brace up your mind. Get your mind ready, because it's going to struggle to believe what you're going to hear. Your mind will not be able to receive. You'll have to receive it with your heart, and you'll have to push it into your mind and renew your mind to be able to receive what your heart can only receive by faith. Okay? So there's a grace to be revealed. At the revelation of Jesus Christ. Is that all right? Angels long to see that. So I trust that we're going to have a great time around the Word of God. And people are going to jump into it. And so just thinking of what we got up till now, 1 Timothy 3:16 would say the following. You can just listen. He says, without controversy. Without controversy. So this is not controversial, what I'm going to say now. If people think it's controversial, it's not. Paul says to Timothy, it's without controversy. Great is the mystery of godliness. God, now listen to the words that I'm just going to use two portions of that scripture. God was made manifest in the flesh. Point number one. Point number two was seen of angels. So there's a mystery in God. And he tells it to us. A. God was made manifest. Manifest in the flesh. John 1:14, the Word was made flesh. B, seen of angels. Okay, we've touched on it many times in this house, but maybe there's some people that do not know it. God is unseen. God said to Moses, no man can see me. No? But yet God revealed a certain portion of himself to Moses. But yet God said over and over, no man can see God. What God was saying is not that you cannot see God. It's that God is invisible. We're going to touch on it later tonight. But when Jesus came, it was God manifest in flesh. Because in John 14, Philip said, show us the Father and that'll be enough for us. Jesus said, Philip, have I been so long with you? Have you not seen me? If you've seen me, you have seen the Father. Because the Father and I are one. I have come from the Father and I'm going back into the Father. John chapter 4, Jesus says to the disciples, the Father is spirit. So the spirit is unseen. You can't see spirit. But out of the spirit realm, the word had to come and be made flesh and dwelt amongst us. And what did we behold? His glory. So when Christ was born, this is why angels were jumping up and down and singing, joy to the world, the Christ has come. This is why the angels were singing, peace on earth and goodwill to men, because for the first time God was seen in flesh. My goodness, it's not just a baby, it's God in flesh. It's the Word that created everything in flesh. In Him we live and move and have our being. Okay, so the mystery of godliness. Here it is, without controversy. God was made manifest in the flesh and was seen of angels. Now, Colossians 1:26 would tell us the following. The mystery that's been hidden throughout ages and generations has now been revealed. Christ in and amongst us. Yes. Amen. It's so rich in glory, yet it's only the hope of glory. Yeah, two glories used there in Colossians 1:20. He says, so rich in glory is this mystery. Christ in and among us, which is the hope of glory. Okay, so that mystery there in 1 Timothy is so rich in glory. Okay. Yet it's only the hope of glory. So if we struggle to understand, it means we've received grace for salvation. Now there's a greater grace waiting for us at the revelation of Jesus Christ, which will bring about something that angels long to see. What did angels see? They saw God in the flesh. God was made manifest in the flesh, seen of angels. So what is angels waiting to see? God manifesting in flesh. God, angels are waiting for flesh to manifest God. They are waiting to see God made manifest in the flesh. That's the only thing that got them excited there, and this is the manifestation. You know what? In Exodus 34, Moses says, God, show me your glory. God says, Moses, I'm going to let my goodness pass before you. And then I'm going to call the name of the Lord before myself. And then here comes God. Mountains are quaking, thunder, lightnings, fire. Moses started hiding himself because God said, I'm going to make a cleft there in the rock where I can hide you behind my hand. So Moses is hiding, and here comes God. For the Lord is good and merciful, slow to anger and quick to forgive. For the Lord is merciful, slow to anger and quick to forgive. Moses fell on his face, and he never looked up to see. He only heard. Then in Numbers chapter 14, the spies come back and they say, 10 of them say, we can't take the land. They say, we have come to the land. It's good as you said. We have seen, you know, the fruit. We have seen the land overflowing with milk and honey. We've seen everything. It was awesome. But we've also seen giants. So we were as grasshoppers in our own eyes. So we were as grasshoppers in their eyes. Caleb and Joshua start throwing sand over themselves and say, no, 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 wait. God said we can take the land. Let's go take the land. God says, Moses, boy, hello. So God and Moses goes to the side, and God says, Moses, I'm going to kill him. So there, Numbers 14. Moses says, God, you can't kill them. God says, how long are they going to tempt me? How long are they going to see my miracles and don't believe me? I'm going to kill them, and I'm going to start a new nation with you. Moses says, no, God. On the mountain, you said you are merciful, slow to anger, and quick to forgive. He only reminds God what God said when he wanted to show the glory. Now, when he reminded God of his mercy and his goodness, God answers back. He says, on your word, I'm not going to now kill him. But as sure as I live, my glory shall fill all the earth. I hope you're getting the full context of the stuff that I've been preaching for years and years and years and years. In other words, Moses, you wanted to see my glory. All I could tell you is I'm good and merciful. Now I want to kill the people, and you remind me of my goodness and mercy, so I still can't kill them. So I'm still good and merciful. But the thing that you asked is still going to come. My glory will one day fill this earth. So there goes the doctrine of the church is going to be taken away and all catastrophes going to break out on the earth and there's going to be wars and rumors of wars. Those prophecies were for Israel in 70 AD. But this world is waiting for something else, not for catastrophe. It's waiting for the glory of God to be seen all over the earth. And God said it three times in the prophets, my glory shall fill all the earth. As the waters cover the sea, my glory shall fill all the earth. So has glory filled the earth? So the church needs to wake up to the grace that must be revealed when Christ is revealed. And when Christ is revealed, we better brace up our minds because it's going to be too big for us. Remember what he said in Acts 13, 38, when Paul preached and he said, I will do a work in your days that even if people tell it to you, it'll be hard to believe. In other words, minds are going to struggle to take this stuff. That's why people are opposing the word that is preached in this place. You've got to have a spirit of revelation, of seeing and hearing and knowing, to understand that God wants to be made manifest in flesh, and angels are waiting to see somebody looking like Jesus, walking around like Christ, talking like Christ. Why are we here for, man? Verse 18, Romans 8. For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. Verse 18, amplified. But what of it? For I consider that the sufferings of this present time, this present life, are not worth being compared with the glory that is about to be revealed to us and in us and for us and conferred on us. Just listen to this. I'll just read it. I wanted to quote it, but I'll read it. I think it's going to sound better when I read it. For our light, momentary affliction, this slight distress of the passing hour is ever more and more abundantly preparing and producing and achieving for us an everlasting weight of glory beyond all measure, excessively surpassing all comparisons, all calculations, a vast and transcending glory and blessedness never to cease. Since we consider and look not to the things that are seen, but to the things that are unseen. For the things that are visible are temporal, but the things that are invisible are deathless and everlasting. For I reckon, Romans, that was 2 Corinthians 4, verse 17 and 18. For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. Must I preach the word? It's just growing for those who want it. More intensity and he says, there's stuff happening around us, but it's momentarily. It's for a fleeting moment. It's passing by. But only if we don't look at them. If we look at the unseen, the invisible. But if we look at the seen is going to sink us. But if we look at the unseen, which is God, invisible, unseen, it is working for us. Thank you, Jesus. A weight of glory that cannot be calculated, that cannot be measured. In other words, they can feed it into computers. Once it starts happening, the masterminds of computer brains will not be able to work out what is happening with that group of people there in Stilfontein. What is that manifestation taking place? What is that glory? What is that light? What is that phenomenon? I don't want to run ahead of myself, but there must be something that must happen. I'm not going to still do that. Hebrews chapter 12 says, look away from distractions by looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. For the joy that was set before him endured the sufferings of the cross. But he didn't look at the sufferings, he looked at the joy. You see, but people go through stuff and they look at stuff. My finances never work out. Speak to the stuff. Give yourself out of calamities. Bring your tithes, your offerings to the storehouse. Test me herein, saith the Lord of hosts. And don't be ridiculous to say it's law. Come and read the word with us. Or suffer. Okay. This pain is killing me. That's right. Let's get you buried and get over with it if it's killing you. Or by the stripes of Jesus, I am healed. I feel so depressed. Or I am more than a conqueror through Christ who loves me. I cannot do this. Or I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. While I don't look at it, it's working glory. But the minute I look at it, the glory goes down again. If I don't look at it, glory starts building up. It's working. An ever-increasing weight of glory beyond all calculations. As truly as I live, this earth is going to be filled with the glory of the Lord. Somewhere there must be a manifestation. What is the attraction on the mountain? Brother, there was a mountain that burned with fire when God came down, and the people of Israel stood shaking as God spoke to Moses, and lightning bolts, thunder was all around the mountain, and fire and smoke went up in the mountain, and now nobody knows there's even a church on the corner. But they stand up and say, we are the ruling church of this city. The business next door don't even know that that is a church. Ephesians 1:23 says, this body of Christ is filling everything everywhere with himself. In other words, if the church walk in some way, I'm carrying the Christ with me, and I'm filling everywhere with Christ. Everything, every. So if I walk into a place, people must take note. I say it to the glory of God. They don't only take note of me in Glasgow because they know me. They take note of me in other countries where they don't even know me. Maybe not in the measure with which I would like to see it. But people come to me in many places and say, excuse me, sir, are you a man of God? Why would they ask me? I'm sure there's other Christians walking around too. And this has happened since I was a young Christian. And right through our lifetime of ministry, Oscar and Elise, people used to come to me. Still now, even when I was sick, people would come to me, excuse me. Are you a man of God? Oh, do you watch us on TV? are you on TV? Huh? So we now think they see us on TV, you know, if they ask us questions. And then they say, no, we don't know TV. Oh, I thought you saw us on TV. Yes, I'm a man of God. No, I just saw something around you. I'm sick. Can you lay hands on me? Other people say, when you passed me by, something happened to my body. Hmm? Now, what about if that full manifestation comes? And they try to touch your clothes. If I can only touch the... No, but that was Jesus. Oh, so who are you supposed to be? Angels are waiting to see God manifest in the flesh. Brother, the end of the month meeting here. Normally you're halfway when there's about still 1,000 people over. I start walking through the aisles. And then the people know I'm maybe not going to stay to the end. Can we just touch you? After they touch me, they're happy. Oh, who are you? What, you also supposed to be? It's not that who am I, it's who are you? Angels are waiting to see God manifesting in you. Now, remember, I just read for you Romans 8 verse, you know, 18 combined with 2 Corinthians 4, 17 and 18 that says exactly the same thing. But 2 Corinthians 4, 13, just listen to it again. We believe, therefore we speak. Chris, he said over and over tonight, do you believe? We believe, therefore we speak. Is that cool? Keep that in mind. I mean, we've said it so many times the last 2 years, but it's going to increase every weekend more and more and more. Okay, verse 19. For the earnest expectation of the creature waiteth for the manifestation of the sons of God. Do you know that sentence? Just press that on the internet and see how people ridicule it, oppose it. Say, oh, there's the Sons of God movement. In the 70s, there was a Sons of God movement. And in the 40s, there was people that called themselves the Sons of God movement. And there are people now that call themselves Sons of God movement. And there are people saying that they're going to be the manifested Sons of God. No, I'm not saying it. I'm just reading it. The expectation of the creature is waiting for the manifestation. Okay. Waiting. 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 For the manifestation of the sons of God. Now, there's only one sentence that goes with sons of God. You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Christ meaning anointed one. You are the anointed one, the Son of God. Now, Jesus said over and over, I'm not going to leave you comfortless. I'm going to give you the Spirit. The same Spirit that made Jesus the Christ makes you. Okay. Verse 20, for the creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly, but by reason of him who has subjected the same in hope. Because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious, glory, come from glory, liberty of the children or sons of God. For we know that the whole creation groans and travails in pain together until now. And not only, here it comes, sir, watching over TV. Not only they, but we ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, to wit or to witness the redemption of our body. Whoa! For we are saved by hope. We are saved by hope. We know the faith thing, the grace thing, we are saved. But hope that is seen is not hope. So I know now that I'm saved when I remember 1 Peter, though we don't see him, we still believe him. For what a man seeth, why doth he yet hope for it? But if we hope for that which we see not, then we with patience wait for it. I don't want to do the rest of the chapter, but we are patiently waiting. Let them accuse us. Let them oppose us. Let them blackball us. Let them badmouth us. Let them gossip and slander about us. At least the cripples are walking and the blind are seeing and the crutches are taken away. At least our debts are paid and at least God is good to us. Okay, but we are waiting because we have the first fruits, and in us there's a groaning saying, I want to be a son of God. I want to be a manifested son of God. I want angels to see God made manifest in the flesh. The grace that will be revealed to us at the revelation of Jesus Christ. So gird up your minds, because this revelation is surely coming. How is it coming, Kobus? For those who's waiting, it's coming right now. It's coming while I'm preaching week after week. For 33 years I've been preaching truth and revelation knowledge. It's coming. It's coming. Okay. Okay. Tonight there's going to be another breakthrough thing coming. I just know it. I just know it. I just know it. I just know it. Let's get back to our board there. Huh? Oh. Huh? Philemon 1:6, Paul is praying that the communication of your faith, communication, in other words, the stuff that comes out of your mouth, the communication of your faith. Now we got there on our board, 2 Corinthians 4:13, because we believe, we speak. We can add there Romans 10:6, the righteousness which is of faith speak. Faith speaks. We know Mark 11:22 through 25, have faith in God. For I say unto you, whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed, and believe in his heart, and no doubt shall have whatsoever he saith. For whosoever saith, okay, three times, you know, he said, have faith in God. So I think faith and belief runs in the same category. Speak, speak, speak. I brought a message a month ago. Don't just stand there. Speak. Say something. I don't know where we were. We were somewhere in Rome. Oh, Philemon. No, that's where we were. That the communication, righteousness of faith speak, because we believe, therefore we speak. If you have faith in God, you will say to the mountain, so speak, speak, speak. Okay? So that the communication of your faith may become effective. If you haven't got the scripture yet, after a month, this is the fourth meeting or fourth weekend that I'm quoting the scripture. The communication of your faith may become effective. In other words, don't just say, oh, speak to the mountain, speak to the mountain, speak to the mountain. Somewhere it must become effective. Now it says the communication of your faith may become effective by the acknowledging of every good thing that is in you, in Christ Jesus. In other words, if I start acknowledging who I am in Christ Jesus, I am a son of God. I am the righteousness of God. I am sanctified. I am justified. I am saved. I am a king. I am a priest. If I start acknowledging it, the communication of my faith will start becoming effective. Why this word thing? Why this communication thing? For the third time tonight, John 1:14, the word, which in verse 1 was the beginning was God and everything was made with him, was made flesh and dwelt amongst us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father. 1 Timothy 3:16, again earlier on tonight. Without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was made manifest in the flesh and was seen of angels. So when the spoken word became a flesh man and started operating again with word on the face of the earth by the power of the Holy Spirit, God was made manifest in the flesh. An angel said, peace on earth, goodwill to men. Now angels are waiting to see how many people are going to receive this grace. Hope to see something that they have not yet seen. Don't look at situations and circumstances, but look into the unseen, the invisible, and have an eternal weight of glory working in them, for them, to them, upon them, and coming forth as the glorious manifested sons of God in the earth today. Hallelujah. With that in mind, Christ must be revealed. 1 Peter 1 verse 1, the prophets prophesied, inquired, searched, when will this happen? Things that angels wait long for. And see, and they said it wasn't for them, but about another type of people that'll come, that'll hear the word. Things that the angels long to start seeing. And Christ must be manifested in the church, in you and in I. Philippians. I hope it's Philippians. I think it's Philippians. It must be Philippians. You've got it now. I think it's only the King James that'll say what I'm going to read now, but it's good enough. It was good enough for Paul. It's good enough for me. In the light of what we are saying, just listen to Philippians 3, verse 20. For our conversation is in heaven, from whence also we look for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall change our vile body, that it may be fashioned like unto his glorious body, according to the working whereby he is able even to subdue all things unto himself. Our conversation is in heaven. In other words, we don't talk earthly trash. So we speak stuff that are heavenly. From where we also look for Jesus, our Savior, our Lord, to do what? To come and take us. Where to? What you going to do after he's taken you? What you going to do then? You can't preach. You can't manifest. I thought we're waiting for our bodies to be redeemed so that we can manifest on the earth with a greater... I thought there's glory that's going to be revealed in us, through us, and upon us. So where do you want to go to if it's supposed to happen here? Okay. So, he says, who shall change our bodies into the very likeness of his glorious body, which he got by being risen from the dead type of stuff. So, I don't know about your Bible, but my Bible says something in Romans 8:11 to this effect. If the same Spirit that raised up Christ from the dead dwell in you, he that also raised up Jesus from the dead shall quicken your mortal body. Come on, we can do better than that. If he that raised up Christ from the dead, no, if the Spirit of him that raised up Christ from the dead dwell in you, Is the Spirit dwelling in you? Then he that raised up Jesus shall also quicken your mortal body. In other words, if mortality is quickened, it becomes? Oh. But he talks about your body. The redemption of your body, the salvation of your body. Ephesians chapter 1, Romans chapter 8, Timothy, you know, etc. So something must happen to us. Hey people, that same Romans 8 says, those whom he called, he predestinated, chosen, foreknown, to become conformed to the image of his Son. If Jesus is the image of the Father, and we have a prayer that Jesus prayed that we will be one with him and one with the Father, and he said, as the Father has sent me, so send I you, then somewhere we must start looking like him. So what will make us like him? The glory. The Spirit. The grace that is to be revealed to us at the revelation of Jesus Christ. So if I start getting this revelation of Jesus Christ, which is actually a revelation of who I am supposed to be, and I don't look at what's happening to me, but I look to the unseen, the invisible, then a weight of glory that cannot be changed or altered will start coming in and upon me. And that glory will be conferred in me, to me, for me, upon me. And then I will come forth as the glorious, manifested Son of God. Then everything around me will be set at liberty, because I have been liberated from the bondage of a son of man, and I become a son of God. He says, by which he is able to subdue all things unto himself. Now, Hebrews chapter 2 from verse 6 says, it is written that what is man that art mindful of him, son of man that you visit him. You've made him lower than angel and set him over the work of your hands and put everything in subjection to him. He said, now in subduing everything to him, nothing is left outside of man's control. But we do not yet see it. In other words, we're going to see it. But we are now able to see Jesus who did it. So if he did it in the flesh, hey people, Adam had an untested life in the cool of the garden. Jesus brought us a tested life through the heat of the desert. He didn't become the son in first creation. He became son after the fall of creation. So Jesus came in flesh after the fall of mankind to prove to you what you can be by the Spirit of God. Let's go to 2 Timothy chapter 1. Let's start at verse 6 that we know so well. Wherefore I put you in remembrance that you stir up the gift of God which is in you by the putting out of my hands. For God has not given us a spirit of fear, but power, love, and sound mind. We know that. Be not thou therefore ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of his prisoner, but be thou partaker of the afflictions of the gospel according to the power of God, who has saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began. Are you ready? Yes. But is now made manifest by the appearing of our Savior Jesus Christ, who hath abolished death and hath brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. Huh? Okay, I'm not going to say anything. I just read. I didn't read in the Amplified that it's not too loud. I just read normal King James. Whereunto I am appointed a preacher and an apostle and a teacher of the Gentiles, for the which cause I also suffer these things. Nevertheless, I am not ashamed. For I know whom I have believed, and I am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day. Hold fast the form of sound words which thou hast heard of me in faith and love which is in Christ Jesus. That good thing which was committed unto thee, keep by the Holy Ghost which dwelleth in us. Words of faith, words of life, the manifestation of the Christ life, indestructible, incorruptible, immortal life. But last night in our prayer meeting, God spoke to me twice, supernaturally. And the one thing was out of 1 Timothy 1, is it 17? 1 Timothy 1, yes. It says, now unto the King eternal, immortal, invisible, unto the only wise God be blessing, glory, honor, forever and ever. Now unto the King eternal, immortal, invisible, the only wise God be glory, honor. And I'm just sitting there in the front trying to play guitar, you know, because these fingers must work. Sometimes I prophesy with them every day. They will work. They will work. So I can do like slowly D, E, and A already, you know. But the others, you know, this one's still A, work you. But... And it took me back to my childhood days. Little boy. Man, did I long to become invisible. I thought, what can I do if I swallow a pearl or press a button or, and I become invisible? And I can sneak into places. And I can do stuff and they don't even know I'm there. Anybody? What? Most of you. Why did you want to become invisible? Okay. And I just thought it would be awesome to become invisible. And then last night God spoke to me. Man, it was so awesome. Says, in S. So, can I not make it two S's? Forgive us for the two S's, because I ride a SS. It's not my car, it's one of my cars, okay? Invisible. Invisible. And I was sitting there, and God says, remember how you wanted to be invisible? Yeah. And he said, and then he dropped this word in my heart, invincible. He said, remember how many times you wanted to be invincible? And I thought of movies that I saw when I was young. The Invincible Boxer, you know. Nobody could beat this guy. And I remember, man. Hey, you don't know who I am, you're underneath. Okay? So, it's my real suit. Okay. But we think of our superheroes when we were boys. Superman, Batman, Spider-Man, you know, Thor, you know, think of all of them. Mr. America, you know, think of all of them. And you think, man, yeah, if I can fly, if I can, Spider-Man, yeah, Batman, I mean, invincible, man, the earth cracks apart and Superman holds it together. Why do we have so much participation now? I preach out of the word for hours. When I show a Superman t-shirt, everybody's involved. And God said to me last night, there on the stage, because of you getting a revelation of who the invisible God is that's dwelling in you, it'll make you invincible. Yes. Write it down. Just like last week, it's your thoughts that is the preview of your life's forthcoming attractions. So write this one down too. It's your revelation of the invisible God on the inside of you that'll make you invincible, indestructible, inconquerable, immortal, Superman, Son of God. Come on, somebody should shout now. Colossians 4 verse 2. Continue in prayer and watching the same with thanksgiving. Listen to this. With all praying also, I hope this is going to bless you. Praying for us, also for us, that God would open unto us a door of utterance. What is utterance? You speak. A door of utterance. To speak. The mystery of Christ. For which I'm also in bonds. That if it's connected to 2 Timothy chapter 1. Look here. Pray to God that he will give us a door of utterance. In other words, that God will give us a door where we can speak. So that we can speak. That people will not oppose and undermine and resist and argue and criticize. But pray that God will give us an open door of speaking where we can speak, man. Listen to this. This is going to freak you out if you've got ears, man. That I may make it manifest as I ought to speak. Verse 6. So let your speech be always with grace, seasoned with salt. Man, I don't know if there's anybody even listening to me right now at this moment of time. In other words, why such emphasis in this church on what we speak? It's your speaking constantly with prayer and thanksgiving and not wavering from what you say by faith that's gonna bring about the manifestation, because faith speaks. We wait for it in hope. Manifested sons, we hope for it. Faith is the substance of things hoped for. We're gonna see it. Keep on speaking it. Amen. My goodness, man, death and life is in the power of the tongue, and he that uses it shall eat the fruit thereof. I bring before you today death and life, goodness and evil, and you know, cursing and blessing. Choose life, man. Speak it. It's in your heart and in your mouth. Speak, speak, speak. Now remember Colossians 1:26. The mystery that's been hidden throughout ages, revelation so rich in glory, Christ in the hope of glory. So let's close with Colossians chapter 3. If you then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above. Remember, we just did our conversation is in heaven. Where Christ sitteth at the right hand of God, set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth. For you are dead and your life is hid with Christ in God. My dear brothers and sisters, are you bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves? You will come rejoicing, bringing in the... Bless you, our guitar player. Right. Listen, for you are dead and your life is hid with Christ in God. Verse 4, when Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory. Now, I wanted to read 4 scriptures here, but I'm not going to read it, so... You can close your Bibles. I'm going to tell it. I wanted to read it. You can go read it at home. You got to do Matthew 17, Mark 9, Luke 9, Acts chapter 1, and Hebrews chapter 12. You got that? Matthew 17, Mark 9, Luke 9, Hebrews 12, and Acts 1. Hebrews 12, what did I say? Yeah. Hebrews 12 and Acts 1. Okay? What I'm going to say, you'll find in there. Okay, here it comes. When Christ who is our life shall appear, then shall you also appear with him in glory. When Christ who is our life shall appear, then shall you also appear with him in glory. When Christ who is our life shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory. I'm not going to do Acts 1 and Hebrews 12. Cut that out of your homework. We can do that at the later stage. Let's just do Matthew 17, Mark 9, Luke 9. After 6 days. Now in Exodus chapter 19, the Bible says, and after 6 days, God took Moses on the mountain. And the glory of the Lord came down upon the mountain. And it was smoking with fire in the earthquakes. So, Matthew 17. And after 6 days, Jesus took Peter, John, and James with him on a high mountain. And his appearance changed, whiter than the midday sun. And his whole being changed. And there appeared unto them Moses and Elijah in glory. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear. Then shall you also appear with him in glory. And he took with him James, John, went up in the high mountain, and his face changed, and his clothes became whiter than the midday sun. And there appeared unto them Moses and Elijah in glory. So when Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall you also appear with him in glory. Now, if the glory of the old was so glorious that Moses had to put a veil over his face, how much greater glory we who are now ministers of the Spirit of the New Testament. So we got to speak not old covenant, we got to speak New Testament. We got to speak life, we got to speak grace, we got to speak truth, we got to speak immortality, we got to speak life. And if we keep on speaking it, There's a revelation coming to us by the grace that's been conferred on us, and we don't look at what's happening, but we look at the unseen, and the invisible of God in us becomes the invisible man, makes us invincible. We become indestructible. We start ruling and reigning, and God looks out of the cloud and says, "This is my son." For to which of the angels did he at any time say, "You are my son, this day have I begotten you"? I will call them by my new name. Not by your new name, by his new name. And I will give unto them a new name, and they will be called by my new name. What is his new name? His name is Jesus. His name is Christ. His name is Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Prince of Peace, Everlasting Father. What was his new name? "This is my son." Never was he called son. Now creation is waiting for sons. James chapter 1. Of his own will have he begotten us. Don't miss it. In other words, as many as received him, to them gave he the power to be called sons of God, as many as believed on his name. Angels are waiting to see God made manifest in the flesh. Sons of God to come in manifestation. The works that I do shall you do. Greater works than these shall ye do, because I go to my Father. And whatever you ask in my name, I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. Did you get that? So Paul says, stir up that gift that you got when I laid hands on you. And start preaching this stuff. That's the context of 2 Timothy 1. So Romans chapter 1 verse 11. I long to be with you, that I could impart some spiritual gift to you, that by the mutual faith of each other, we will both be edified. So tonight, by the laying on of my hands, I'm going to impart some special gift so that you will start communicate and stir up the gift that is in you and start speaking who you are in Christ and stop talking situations and circumstances and I can't and I don't and I can't see and I don't have and I am struggling and I am suffering. Start saying, don't wait till you lie in a hospital bed, struggle to breathe before you start saying what God says. Start saying it now. And if you get there, it'll carry you through. The spirit of a man sustains him in his sick bed. But a weak spirit, who can bear it up? So how do I make my spirit strong? Saying what God says. Realizing who I am. 1 Corinthians 15:10. By the grace of God, I am what I am. And I will not frustrate the grace of God. Creation is waiting for you. For you. For you. And for you. To come forth as a manifested son of God. So what's going to happen tonight? Well, if you're sick, when I lay hands on you, be healed. But tonight we're not going to specially pray for the sick, apart from our ladies there from PEL, specially pray for you. But the rest of you, I just feel that get what you need to get, but with all you're getting, get the anointing of what I preach tonight. Everybody say, whatever was preached here, I receive. My spirit, my soul, and my body will be kept blameless until the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. I will become a perfect man in my whole man. I will be a manifested, matured, perfected, adopted son of God with power and authority to subdue creation under my feet. In Jesus' name, I rule and reign. In this life, the invisible God on the inside of me makes me an invincible person. Indestructible, unconquerable, immortal. Son of God. That's who I am. In Jesus' name. Is that awesome? Cool. Right? Let's do it. I've got some holy oil there. We're going to put it here in the front. Whoops. We're going to start anointing people, lay hands on you.